हेलो डॉक्टर शेखर।
सर, गुड आफ्टरनून सर, हाउ आर यू?
गुड आफ्टरनून। ऑल वेल डॉक्टर शेखर,
ओके सर, फाइन
हाउ इज इट गोइंग?
सर. दे आर ज्वाइनिंग बिकॉज गूगल लिंक ना
या
टुडे
देव शिफ्टेड फ्रॉम गूगल लिंक टू दिस।
देर आर थ्री लेक्चर्स.
या ओनली टू लेक्चर्स सर टुडे.
ओके
या सो देर इज अ प्रॉब्लम आई थिंक ऑफ जूम लिंक.
Okay.
We are sent. They will be joining, sir, soon.
Yeah, it might take some time, sir, because this is a new link basically for them.
New na.
Yes, Google Meet is a new link.
Yeah, sir, exactly. Okay. How are you, sir? Rajesh, sir.
All well, all well.
Oh, great, sir.
Okay. In Pune, sir.
What?
Are you in Pune or Hyderabad, sir? Delhi.
No, no. I am in my native place, Jabalpur.
Okay, Jabalpur, sir.
Yeah, my aunt was hospitalized. Now she is discharged from the hospital.
Okay.
So,
Thanks.
Hi, Dr. Subi.
Subhi Chai. The main.
So, sir, elections over. Elections are over at your sector. Sir, sir, 4:30 को फंक्शन होगा तो कब तक चलेगा? मेरा प्लान है कोंडा जी का देख लेंगे पहले, एक इस वीक में या नेक्स्ट वीक में. तो देखने के बाद हाँ, वहाँ मिल जाएंगे तो शिफ्ट कर लूँगा सर, क्योंकि यहाँ थोड़ा रेंट ज़्यादा हो रहा है सर. सर कम्यूनिटिंग बहुत इजी है सर.
So good afternoon, Sobe.
कम्यूटिंग ही तो 15 मिनट का रास्ता है. 7.5 hours.
यशु.
हाँ हाँ.
नो प्रॉब्लम. गूगल लिंक टुडे इज गूगल लिंक.
तो सर ओके ओके, हम रेडी होना चाहिए वहां से.
ओके नो प्रॉब्लम नो प्रॉब्लम नो प्रॉब्लम. दे आर जॉइनिंग स्टिल. ओके. डॉक्टर सुधाकर.
हाँ सर.
हाँ, ही विल बी, ही इज हैविंग सम प्रॉब्लम इन द इन हिज सिस्टम. डॉक्टर जयसुराजन.
अच्छा,
सो ही विल टेक अनदर 5 मिनट्स टू जॉइन.
Okay, sir. Any problem, then he can call to Deepesh also so that he can help.
Yeah, no problem. No, the issue is not there, but
okay.
His system has a problem, laptop. So
okay.
He is going to
that's
another
fine,
room.
Yeah, we'll wait for
yeah.
sir. We'll wait for him, sir.
Yeah, because there are some others are also facing some problem.
Yeah, because the Google Meet, no, sir.
No, yesterday first day we have 100 around 120. Second
yes.
day we have 76. Sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, because some are having, we are also having other meetings also.
Sir, okay.
We are postponing.
Okay.
After
okay.
four, we have some more meeting.
Ah, sir.
So I have already talked to that Jwala Jindal, who is in PAU, na. So for that zone, he will be giving management also. That I will be sending tomorrow.
Okay.
Monday, I will send the topics because that zone has a. Practically, the first season incidents, we can say it as it.
Okay.
So they need some management to what they have done. That also I am including the first day with Sharon Basappa will continue natural ecosystem, natural enemy. So this lecture will be addition to that one.
Okay, sir.
So now, the November lectures, we will be having 4 states, na, UP, and then. We'll be having UP, then Jharkhand, Bihar, West Bengal.
Yeah.
And maybe we'll ask Assam also
uh-huh.
to join.
Okay, sir. Good, sir.
So they those people will join. So lectures will be same for that Bihar. We may not be adding any.
Uh-huh.
For Northeast region, we are requesting a person from the Northeast to give the natural enemies.
Okay.
That zone is more of biopesticide, bio agents, na?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Organic states are less Sikkim. So exactly. We concentrate more on the natural.
Natural. Enemies. Yes.
So we have trying to contact a scientist. Already Subi has done that one.
Mm-hmm.
So he will be joining with the natural enemies of any age region.
Okay.
And members will give the natural enemies existing peninsular zone so that they can get the those cultures or strains from the NBAR. Mm. So that is our intention. I will pass on the message. Yes. Next week I will finalize all the two training. Third, fourth, fifth. I have already finalized.
Okay.
Only some people has to one has to commit.
Yes. Yeah.
To give that like any region.
Yes, sir. Yes. Sir, in message chat box, so we have the YouTube link also. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, that I have circulated. They know it.
Yeah, then it's fine.
We have circulated to our colleague Pijay Karna, who is looking after all these things, Google Forms and all.
Okay.
He will be circulating that one. I have given a message to him.
Good, sir.
And also our colleague MK Mehla from Udaipur.
Okay.
He is also coordinating, so I have shared the link to them.
Okay.
Yesterday's I got really good feedback regarding the Metarhizome, na?
Yes,
especially Jashi, that there are certain problems.
Yeah.
They can get the clear indication what are the humidity conditions required, what are the strains required. Mm-hmm. That is more important.
Yes.
Jesu has joined.
Okay.
Jesu has joined. So we will wait another 5 minutes, friends.
Yeah.
Yes, Dr. Shekhar, 27 people have already joined. You can start after 3 or 5 minutes.
Yes, sir. We will start, sir, after five minutes.
Right.
Because they are joining now.
Okay.
Yesterday also first started with 40. Later on, because Satyanarayan was on the way to Krishi Bhavan, so we started it day before yesterday.
Sir, yesterday you were telling about so many registrations were there.
Yeah, that is the issue. Huh. How come it has come, but why they have not joined? He says, PJ says more than 900 registrations.
Yes, sir. That's what I am expecting. Yeah. How many people will join?
It is good, Sudhakar. It is one good thing is that maybe that is a message came from our colleague who has submitted the circulated the forms, registration forms.
Uh-huh.
Somehow we are giving YouTube link now. Now yes. Many people are asking, I am forwarding the links.
Yes. Then it's fine.
They want to see it. Maybe it is good also.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is good also to see how it is going on.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Dr. Jeshurajan, welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have some problem in Zoom because it is busy. Many meetings are going on. Na? That's why today they have given us the Google link.
Yeah, no. Okay, sir.
We'll start in another 5 minutes because they are facing some problem in joining.
Sure. Okay, sir. No problem, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sir, Rajesh, sir. Sudhakar, we have received last PPT of Nagaraj sir also today. Today he was traveling. He sent me the message that he has mailed the PPT to me, but some two slides he want to add. So I told sir, by evening you send it to me. Then we will make the PDF send back to all the participants. Swain sir, namaskar.
Sir, namaskar.
Namaskar, kaise hai?
Sir, theek thaak sir. सर आप कैसे हैं सर?
ठीक है बढ़िया चल रहा है
सर।
We are constructing a new insect screening net house for FAR. Already we have one. Our NASF it screens around 400 lines. Now we are getting another 1,000 square meter net house.
Sir.
So that will also screen around 600 rows.
Yes, sir. So this time I have to send some samples of FAW larva.
Larva, you have to send it to NBIR or to Subi, Dr. Subi.
Yes, sir. I have already sent. Already I have sent.
You can send it to Dr. Subi.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Sir, we have got samples from most of the partners. Yes, sir. Most of the ACIP partners.
Okay, that's good, Subi. It is our main thing now.
Yeah.
So that we can go ahead. मेहला सर नमस्कार कैसे हैं?
सर बढ़िया है सर अच्छे सर
बढ़िया बढ़िया सर आपको यूट्यूब लिंक भी भेजा हूँ
यस सर
या
मैंने भी शेयर किया है सर काफी देखे
या वी आर वेरी थैंकफुल टू फ्रेंड्स फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी थैंक आवर लोकल कोऑर्डिनेटर्स फॉर दिस ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम दैट इज डॉक्टर एम के मेहला एंटोमोलॉजिस्ट एंड बायो कंट्रोल स्पेशलिस्ट इन दट एएसआरपी प्रोग्राम इन मेज एट उदयपुर and Dilip Singh is also AACRP agronomist, Sunil Karad from Kolhapur, S.R. Dwande from Rahuri, M.B. Patel from Godhra, and Gaurav Mahajan from Chindwada, S.K. Sinha from Ambikapur, and Dr. Swain from Orissa Agricultural University. These are our local AACRP maize center persons who has coordinated in this program. So circulating all the links to the concerned state departments and all. We are very thankful to our colleagues in conducting in this program. And the man behind all these things is Dipesh Solanki, and then Dr. Rajesh Dubey from FAO, National Coordinator. They are the main person coordinating in this program. Sir, shall we start now? Sudhakar, shall we start?
Yes, sir. Already we have.
So, yeah, they will join. Na? So, friends, welcome to the third day training program. Today is the last day of the program. Thank you for joining in this program. And today we have two presentations. One is on farm production protocols of predators for the management of fall armyworm. To be delivered by the Dr. Jayasurajan, scientific officer at NIPHM Hyderabad. He has a lot of experience in management of predators and parasites. And second one is agro-ecosystem analysis and landscape management of fall armyworm. To be delivered by Dr. S.B. Subi, our colleague, and S.L. Jat from ICRIMR. So now I request Jayasurajan to deliver the first presentation on predators for fall armyworm management, how we can mass produce. And Jayasurajan is working as a scientific officer entomology at NIPHM. He has technical skills for mass production of insect predators and parasites and specialized in IPM and protected cultivation. Presently working as a scientific officer, and earlier also he was assistant scientific officer in 2015 and promoted as scientific officer in 2019 October. And he has interest in the ecological engineering in plant health management, efficiency of bioagents under protected cultivation. He has 34 publications and two books and two book chapters. And he has also got DST Cert Fast Track Young Scientist Award in 2015. Now I welcome Dr. Jayasurajan to deliver the important presentation on predators. We have learned about bioagents, egg parasitoid, egg larval parasitoids, larval parasitoids, microbial agents, entomopathogenic nematodes, entomopathogenic fungi, bacterial agents, all the things we have learned till yesterday. Today they will be giving on predators, how these can be effectively utilized through the agroeconomic analysis. So welcome Dr. Jesharajan.
Thank you, sir, for your brief introduction. So now I will start my section. Sir, is audible, sir?
Yeah, audible.
So good afternoon to all. So my name is Jesharajan. I am working as a scientific officer entomology at NIPHM. So now I am going to explain about the on-farm protection protocol of predators for the management of fall armyworm. So in predators, I think last 2 days the scientists there explained about the import, what are the major role of different parasitoids and predators and other bio agents. So now I'm going to explain about the only predators. So first, I think whatever I mentioned here, these all predators is recorded in our fall armyworm in maize ecosystem. The first one is earwing. It's a very common under the Dermapteran insects. It's a very good predator for feeding of both the egg stage of eggs and the tiny larvae of fall armyworm. The second important predator is a ladybird beetle. It's a very common, not only for this insect, it's a common predator. This also, it is one of the important predator against fall armyworm. The third important predator is a redwood bug. The common name is assassin bug. This redwood bug is feeding on the larvae, actually, larva of fall armyworm. This also is recorded in fall armyworm. The next one is a pentatomid predator bug. Its scientific name is Eucundagna persillata. This is one of the good predator. This record also is there in the fall armyworm. The next predator is anthoporid predatory bug.
Slide movement is not going on, sir.
Sorry?
Slide movement is...
Slides are not moving, Vijay, sir.
Yeah.
Oh. 1 minute, sir. This moving, sir?
Not moving.
Sorry, you're able to see the only first slide.
First slide only.
Just 1 minute.
Any problem? Can reshare the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes. Now it is visible, sir.
Your desktop, sir? Is visible now. We have to open it.
Oh, only desktop I can see.
Sudhakar, anything you have done?
No, sir.
Sir, here it is going on, sir. They are not visible, sir.
You just
not
open visible. The slide, sir. Open the PPT.
Sir, already opened, sir.
But you could not able to see that one, no?
Aray.
Rejoins one, sir. After that, did we show it?
What is the problem?
Only 1 minute, sir.
Please check it.
Yes.
Can I pass any of your training?
Sir,
पीडीएफ कर सकते हैं इसमें? देखते हैं हो सकता है तो उनको एडमिट किया है ना, हमें करना है कितना दिक्कत होगा।
सर इज विजिबल सर नाउ?
Not this, sir. It's a problem.
Here is showing correct, sir. Now my folder is showing, sir. Folder is there, sir.
Now it is.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, we could able to see your folder.
Now the presentation came, sir.
Now it has started.
No.
Double click.
Showing folder only.
Now it is okay, sir. Full screen is there, sir.
Your desktop has opened now.
Like previous folder only. Sir. Not open PDF.
हम शेयर कर सकते हैं तो किसका? हाँ इनका यूवर फोल्डर ही होता है। हाँ सम प्रॉब्लम फ्रॉम आवर साइड।
स्टॉप प्रेजेंटिंग समथिंग इट इज़ तेरे यूवर प्रेजेंटिंग टू एवरीवन।
चंद्रशेखर सर आस्क हिम टू शेयर टू यू सर अदरवाइज वी विल ट्राई टू
नो आई एम सीइंग इट ना वी विल सी इट
your entire screen
mere mein se kar sakte hai kya? Yes sir. Yes,
now it is okay.
Yes, okay sir. Yes,
yes. Yeah, it is there now. Screen is there, you can
yeah,
now it is coming.
Yeah. Thank you sir.
Yeah.
Now it is slide moving, sir.
Yes, yes. Google Meet. Google is paisa ama
Google. Sir, that slide is moving, sir. First slide is there, sir. Predator of Fall Army Bomb.
No. Yes,
in
slide is not moving.
It's not moving, sir.
Not moving.
Now it
is moved. Yeah, now it came.
Okay, then I will present like that only, sir. Not full screen. I will make it present here like that only. So sorry for delay this one. So this all are whatever I mentioned here. This is a very common predator in Fall Army Bomb. First one is a earwing, Ladybird Petit, Red Wing Bug. Pendatome meat bug, Anthogore bug, Bickey bug, green lace wing. This all are is a very common predator. Particularly is recorded in maize ecosystem. Now I am going to explain about the mass production technology, because this main role is mass production only. So now I am going to explain one by one. First predator, red wing bug. Actually, three species. Till now, these three species recorded in maize ecosystem. One is Rhinochoris fuscibus, Rhinochoris marginatus, and Cycanus collaris. These three is a very common predator in maize ecosystem. This is introduction. So this is a cosmopolitan distribution. The family Redividae. You know, Redividae almost 90% of the redwood are predators only, insect predators. Only one or two species only. It's a one species, the one subfamily, Tritomini, that is have a blood-sucking insect, Thermotaphagus insect. Another one family, Ectricodinae, is a millipede feeder. Remaining all subfamilies under the Redipidae is a predators. Yeah, this photo you see here. The first photo is a Thermotaphagus insect. It's a Tritomini is feeding out the blood-sucking feeder. This second one, this you see the Carbocterinae, Redivinae, Sedum, so many subfamilies, all subfamilies. Maximum 90% of the redwood bug is a predators. Under the redwood, there is no pest. This only one subfamily is a Hematophagous insect. Another one subfamily is feeding only the millipedes insects. Now I'm going to explain here the how to identify the redwood bug in the field condition. That is very, very important, because maximum scientists, they are confusing about the predator and the pest. Here you see, particularly for these two, is a very important one, between the cotton bug, red cotton bug, and the redwood bug. This look like same structure, but you see the one, I will explain one or two points only in field condition. In mouth parts, you see the mouth parts here. In redwood bug, the mouth parts is a very short and stout. But at the same time, here you see the mouth parts is a very lean and long. This is the major identification between the redwood bug and the red cotton bug. This Chemipteran insects, you know, I think 5 Niphal instar total. The next is adult stage. Here both Niphal stage and adult, both are is a predators only. Both stage are predators. Now directly I'm coming to the point for mass production. So very simple method for mass produce of this redwood bug. You will take one small plastic container. You see the photo here, that first one I put the plastic big container. It's almost 30 centimeter width. The second one is a small. If you want, it will grow only one or two pair, you make it a small container. You put together almost a 10 pair, you make it in the big container, a big tub, plastic tub is enough. Just you put the soil, 1 or 2 centimeter, then you spread the water, sunset for just over 2 days. Nothing for sterilize of the soil and this tub, that's all. After sterilization, you see the photo here, the second one, you put some corrugated paper. Just you make the zigzag method, you take in chart paper, black color chart or brown color chart, whatever, maximum you will take black color, it is good actually, it got good result. So you will make it that zigzag method. Then you put inside the container, inside the tub, plastic tub. The third important point is food for redwood bug. So any larva in laboratory condition, carcera is very easy. Otherwise, if any Lepidopteran host, because it's a piercing and a sucking type of mouth parts, so better you will put larval seed. That's a very, very important larva. The second important point is you put healthy and live larva. That is also very important points. We have the predators, na? Maximum is prefer live and healthy larva. So for example, in big container, for example, this big tub means you put a minimum or a 10 pair of redwood bug. 10 pair means 20 insects. So minimum 20 to 30 larva is required per day inside the container. Just you will release inside the container. Then next, redwood bug. Small container means you put only one pair, one male, one female. Otherwise, big ones, you release more than one pair. But accordingly, release the food, that is very, very important, larvae. Otherwise, what happened? Cannibalism will happen. You know that predator's characters. So just after release of this redwood bug, adult, young adult, you cover with muslin cloth. So what is the work here? Every alternate days, at least every 2 days, you will open the mustin cloth. You remove the dead larvae because it's a piercing and a sucking. So suck the only body fluid from the larvae so that dead larva is there, maybe some infected larva, something it is. Just you remove all the dead ones, then you release a fresh larva. That is very, very important food. The second one, you collect the eggmas because the female vaccines lay the eggs on the below the chart paper. You see, just you will open the corrugated paper. Below the corrugated paper, you see maximum females is lay the eggs on the group cluster form. You see the photo how it is there. Maximum the dreadweed bug lay the eggs on the group only cluster form. One cluster means maximum minimum 40 to 50 eggs are there. So this is the egg mass. So just you collect the egg mass. Don't collect with remove the egg mass. Just you will cut the paper only. The black chart paper is there. Wherever egg mass is there with the scissor, just you will cut along with the chart. You keep in the petri plate. That is very, very important. Don't disturb the eggs. So just you will wait for 7 to 10 days. Maximum 7 to 10 days on incubation period. The egg will catch. So here I am telling one important point. Suppose this catching the egg. So whenever you put the petri plate, the climate, just you will check the climate, temperature and the humidity. You suppose it's more than 30 or 35 degrees there, better will keep some wet cotton inside the petri plate. Just you will maintain the temperature and the humidity. That is very, very important. At the same time, you will check the petri plate. If any fungal, anything will happen, you will remove or cut. This is very, very important to avoid the fungal infection also. So within 7 to 10 days maximum, that eggs, 90 to 100% eggs will catch. You see the next photo, how that nymphs is there. Very small nymphs. It look like ants only. It's very small. I am telling one point here. The first instar after birth, after cooking, from first instar onwards is a predator. That is very, very important. So what we'll do, for example, one petri plate, one egg mass is there, means minimum 50 to 60 nymphs is coming from the single egg mass. So you put a small larvae. That is very, very important. Very small larvae. Don't put the big pada, carcera or spodoptera larvae. Very small larvae, tiny larvae. Just you release inside the petri plate. That's very important. So it will grow on the petri plate itself only. It will make it a 10 per petri plate. 10 number of nymphs per petri plate. You will make it like that. You will add the food. One or two larvae is enough. Just you will maintain 10 days. 10 days means almost a second instar, up to second instar. From third instar onwards, I'm telling here, from third instar onwards, it's a voracious predator. Okay, this need more food. So in the petri plate, it's very difficult to rear up to the adult. So better you will keep in the big first dimension, how we are maintaining the same like that. From third instar, further for mass protection, I'm telling, for further mass protection. Okay, so third instar, just you transfer to big container. That's very important. Otherwise, it directly released into the field. So whatever insect is there, because you know one single egg mass itself only will collect 56 nymphs. So you are maintaining for over 10 pair adult mate. Just you will imagine how many number of nymphs will come. So whatever the third instar, after reaching the third instar, directly released into the field. That is very, very important. Don't grow up to the adult, because compared to the adult, nymphal instar is a good predator. So how is feeding, you see here? Here, total 5 nymphal instar. Total 5 nymphal instar. 5 nymphal instar means almost the duration 45 to 50 days. The only single adult, the adult one, single adult itself only, maximum it is lay the eggs, 2000 eggs during the life cycle. So because you know that adult is survey more than 5 months. Okay. So that time maximum the females is lay the eggs 40 to 50 times. Just you imagine how many number of eggs will collect from the single females. So whatever the nymphs will come directly release into the field. That is very, very important. It's a very easy method for rearing of this red bean. So the field release 3,000 to 5,000 per hectare for larvae. Third nymphalinster, to release the third nymphalinster predator. So I don't know this video is working or not. I think it's not working. I will show later this all videos I have. The next important predator is a pentadomid predatory bug. This is very good predator, particularly in maize ecosystem. This is two species of pentadomidae, predatory pentadomidae, is recorded for against fall armyworm also. Here that life cycle, the duration, the total life cycle is very short time, maximum is 60 days only, 60 to 70 days only. The same five nymphalinster, here also both nymphs and adults, both are is a predator. Here you see the nymphs, how did they? The first instar, here only one small modification, same procedure for mass production. But here when one small change is there, the egg mass, you see the eggs after catching, the nymphs, all nymphs is making the group actually. The first feeding is prefer only the leaves only, like pest, they suck from the leaves, only first feeding. The next feeding onwards is start the larva. Okay, so this is very, very better. You will take very easy method, you will take brinjal leaves. Actually, I'm rearing here. You will take the young leaves from brinjal, you'll put it inside after catching. The first feeding, it will take the suck from the brinjal leaves. The next onwards, it will start the predator. Okay, you see, you put the larva. But this is a very good predator. Naturally, it is there in our field. You see how it is feeding of that larvae and the different instars and the molting of the things. The next important predator is anthogorid predatory bug, the Plasmodis species pallescens. But this is a very good predator against mites and thrips, particularly, including aphids also. But in maize ecosystem, we are observed this predator is feed the eggs and tiny larvae also, tiny larvae of fall armyworm. Just if you see the video, I will show the video here. I already took the video from this field. So this is predator, this anthogorid predator, how is feeding the larvae. I have video, but it's here, it's not running. I will share later. So this is morphological identification. I am directly go for the mass production. So this technology developed by Dr. Chandis Palal madam from NVIR. So maximum this predator is prefer the mites, particularly mites, aphids and thrips. In polygous condition, I think maximum scientists, they know they're using this predator against mites. But at the same time, the same predator is feeding the tiny larvae also. You see here that a first photo, this is eggs of this Plasmodis species. This predator is not lay the eggs in the like open field, open place. It's required French pin. Okay, so for mass production, I will explain later after the next slide. Maximum this female is lay the eggs on the vegetables, in the layer of the vegetable, plant tissue. This nymphs is feeding on the mites. This is adult. Adult is feeding Lepidoptera eggs and tiny larvae also. This is the biology of Plasmodis species. The progenic production, you see here, the nymphs per female, almost 150 to 200 are there per female. This is a very short time. So within the short term, this many number of NIMS is derived from single female, because it's very difficult counting the egg here, because that is eggs is lay the on the vegetable lay. So maximum we are counting the NIMS only. So now I'm coming to the point for mass production. So we will take one small container, glass or plastic beaker. 2 liter glass beaker is okay. So better, this is very easy method. Otherwise, after you collect that beaker, glass beaker, you put on tissue paper. Along with the tissue paper, you'll put some cotton. So after releasing of after put the cotton, is required food. So what is a food? Carcera larva. So that is very, very important. UV treated carcera larva, that's very, very important. So why I'm telling this point here, suppose without UV irritated, you release that carcera larva, that carcera will make a catching, after catching they will make it the web inside the container. To avoid the web, battery will go for UV treated. Okay? UV treated carcera egg. That is very, very important. Just you spread it inside the beaker, then directly you release into the adult of predator, anthogorid bug. So this anthogorid bug, if you want, you collect from a laboratory, any PHM or any other, like NBIR is available, any other state department. Also don't collect from the field, because identification, something is very difficult, better you will take from any institute or laboratory. So after releasing this predator, here one of the important points is required to maintain the temperature and humidity. That is very, very important. So what we just is soak the water, cotton, and keep the side of the wall with the wet cotton, okay, to maintain the temperature and the humidity inside the beaker. So just you cover the muslin cloth, because the adult is maximum feed on the carcera eggs only inside the container. The sixth point is very, very important. You will put some French bean. Don't put any other vegetable. We have tried all the things from NBR also. Maximum this predator for egg laying is prefer only the French bean only. So you will take French bean, you will make it the small piece, and you keep inside the container for oviposition. That is very, very important. So maximum that adults is lay the eggs, loose eggs only on the French bean, the layer, that layer of the French bean. So every day, just you will see inside the things, you collect the egg, that French bean along with the eggs, okay? If you want, you will check the microscope, it will easily to identify that one. First photo is seeing how the eggs is there. Otherwise, you'll keep in separate container, just to wait for catching. After catching, directly release into the fresh container for further mass production. Otherwise, directly release into the field. This is a very good predator for control of mites, particularly mites, and also is now recently there for is feeding of the tiny larvae and the eggs of the fall amoeba. So already I explained here, UV treated carcera is very, very important, and water soap cotton also is very important. Then only for a egg also it will catch. And here what is the problem is there, main thing cannibalism is there. You know, all predator have cannibalism. The second problem, you put the sufficient number of UV treated carcera eggs. That's very important points. Second one is fungal infection, because you know, inside you are always keeping the wet cotton, and also your French bean. That is very, very important. So this both may be it is possible for fungal infection. So to avoid the fungal infection, daily, every day we'll check that container to remove the infected one. That is very, very important. And every fortnightly you clean the adult container, because you know that lot of infection it will happen inside the container. To clean regularly, otherwise what happen, within short time, maybe within 1 or 2, if some infection will happen, means within short time all culture will collapse. That is a major problem in this species. The next important predator is a green lacy. So it's a very good predator. It's a very common predator. But they're telling it is one of the characteristics there is a feed in the aphid. That's why it's called aphid line. Common name is aphid line, green lacewing. Particularly this grub stage is a predator. Adult is not predator. It's grubs that is feeding the eggs also. You see the life cycle. Here only grub stage is a predator. Adult is not predator. The adult is living very short time only, maximum 20 to 30 days only. The single females is lay the eggs almost minimum 300 to 500 eggs during the life cycle within short time, within 20 days. Sometime some record is there 800 also there. But the female is lay the eggs in the stock egg. You see the photo how the egg mass is there, eggs are there, stock egg. But his photo is look like is a white color, but it is a green color, light green color actually. Is dog the egg, okay? The egg will catch within 3 to 5 days. Total 3 grub stages there, 3 stages. These 3 stages is the predator. It's very small predator. Is maximum the grub stages 8 to 10 days, maximum 12 days. That's all. Okay, these 12 days only is a predator. So next is a pupa, then pupa to adult. It will emerge in 5 to 7 days only. So this video also is not working here. So this is a how this chrysoperla how is feeding the fall amoebum eggs. You see here. So now I'm coming to the point for mass production. Chrysoperla, it is very easy for mass production under the laboratory condition. So you will try, you take any option. If you want, you will take in small beaker also, a 2-liter beaker, plus beaker you will take. Otherwise, in this is available in open market. In online also is available. That is called the Chrysoperla breeding nest. Chrysoperla breeding nest is derived from the TNAU, actually this one. Here, what are the things is there? Already I told adult is not predator. Adult is not predator. So is required of artificial diet. In natural condition, this adult is feeding the nectar or pollen from the flowers. But in laboratory condition, is required artificial diet. So what will do? You prepare the artificial diet like yeast, fructose, honey, protein X, water. Just you noted this very, very important. This all is available in the medical shop. So just you will take 1:1 ratio all. Just a tiny amount is enough. Don't make it in the like half liter or 1 kg. So every fresh diet was prepared. Always we prepare the fresh diet. That's very, very important. So whenever is required, you prepare that time only. That is very, very important. But just you take 1 pinch of yeast, fructose, honey, and the protein is and water. You mix all the things, soak with the cotton and stick the side of the wall. So after preparation of this chrysoperla, that artificial type, then you release inside the container, adult, okay, adult of chrysoperla. So here also I'm telling the same thing, you collect from the any laboratory condition, don't collect from the field. So before releasing the adult, we prepare this lid, okay? So very easy, just you will take a black color or brown color short paper, you will make it as a lid here. We'll make it small holes also in above the lid. Then you help of rubber band, you close this beaker. So the female maximum is lay the eggs on the top of the maximum, the black color chart only. Otherwise you'll do one thing, you keep inside the container also one strips, black color strips you keep inside the container. Maximum the female is lay the eggs on the chart paper only. So just you collect the all the eggs, you keep in the separate container for catching. After catching here, that's very, very important. So each and every crop should be maintained separate container. That is very important points. you put together means what happened is a more cannibal somatic because I'm already I told grub stage only is a predator. So more cannibalism is there to avoid the cannibalism. What we'll do, each and every grub should be made in this separate container. So just it will take syringe bottle, just 50 paisa or 120 only there. Otherwise, small plastic container also no problem. Just it will make it, lead to you make it the hole. Syringe bottle, what will you will use cotton as a lead. Okay, that's a very easy method. So before releasing this chrysoperla. Sorry, yeah, chrysoperla grub. Food is required. What is the food? Castor eye eggs only. Same castor eye egg. So you will go for UV treated. After UV treated, the castor eye eggs you will keep inside the big container. Just a small quantity is enough because it's a very short time. The grub stage only 8 to 10 days only. Okay, so very small quantity is enough each and every container. After UV treated, just you keep inside the container. So here there is no need of any caring because already UV treated carcera only, there is no problem. Is sufficient food for this grub stage. You just after 10 days, just you open the container, you know how the adult is. The maximum that grub stage maximum is reaching to the pupal stage. The pupa you keep in the separate container for merging the adult. Here I'm telling some important points. That mass multiplication is very easy, but here what is the problem is there field release. So as per the recommendation, tiny larva, there's a small first insta larva, chrysoperla larva, that is the recommendation is there to release field release. But what is the problem is there after releasing this chrysoperla? Mortality rate is very high. Is the success maximum 30% only, not 30 also, below 30 only did there. That is one of the main problem it did there. So recently from Gujarat, I think from Anand Agriculture University, they released one paper like trichocard. How trichocard is the same like that is a chrysocard also. Okay, so they'll make it the stable here and there because we know that stocked egg only. The third option, one more option is there. How we will make it? For example, I am sewing one oviposum chamber. That small container, like whatever the glass beaker is there, we are maintaining maximum 40 to 50 adult only. But a big container means you will thousands number of chrysoperla you put inside the container. Every day you collect more than thousands number of eggs. So you collect all this very easy, just wait for 1 day after, because first day is a flexible egg, the second and the third day is not flexible that much. So just you will use with the cotton, you crop all the egg, you collect you mix with the dry cocopit and you spread into the field. That is very easy method. So anyway, both whatever you release in the both adult are eggs are this tinilla grub stage also. What is the problem is there some survey percentage dead mortality is there. So to avoid this one, particularly for this chrysoperla field release, some more research is required. But anyway, this is one of the important predator. It's very good predator for field condition. So 50,000 per hectare twice during the season with a cap of 15 days. The next important predator, ladybird beetle, is a very common predator. Not only for this one, it's a very common predator. I think I don't want to explain for these common points. So here I'm telling the life cycle. You see the ladybird beetle, coccinellates. Almost, I think 90% of the coccinellates are except one or two species like Epilacna. I mean, I think all are predators only. Here, almost 90% of the coccinellates predator is a aphid feeder. Some of the one or two species like Cryptolemus mandrus or Simnus coxivora, some one or two species only is a feeding of the millipug feeder. Like Ilia species, you know, that is a feed on that powdery mildew, like fungus. Okay. So this predator, particularly for this aphid feeder, this coccinellate is feed on the eggs and eggs of Lepidopteran eggs also. So this adult is laid egg. You see the egg mass, how it is there, maximum 8 to 10 eggs are there, is yellowish color. The egg will catch within 3 to 5 days. It's a very small grub. From here, both grub stage and adult, both stages are a predator. Both are predator only. So that after the grub stage is become the pre-people, then people stage, then emerge into the adult. So the adult is living maximum 2 to 3 months also. So here I'm telling, going to explain about the mass production of coccinellid. So coccinellid is required food. So whatever previously I'm explaining, food as a carcera only, carcera eggs or larvae. But here is required aphid. So first we'll grow the aphids. How we'll grow the aphid? Very easy. So each and every kitchen is available the mustard seed. So just you'll sow the mustard seed. You see the how the trays is there. You'll make the tray and you'll put the vermicompost and cocoa pit, you mix and you put the this one, mustard seed. Mustard is one of the trap crop of aphid. So it is very easily is infected by aphid. So after infection, so there's one more important point, aphid, you know, I think, so some parasitoid is there. Some hyperparasitoid also is there, is attack both aphids and also grubs of coccinellids. So to avoid that one, what will you maintain pure aphid culture inside the mustard plant. This is very, very important. So after growing this aphid, now each and every, you are maintaining minimum 10 sets of aphid culture. Here you collect the adults of coccinellid from the field, local species, whatever it is species there, you collect, that's no problem. Because you collect only the adult, don't collect in the grub stage. So better you will take in the adult stage. For example, one container is almost the length minimum 40 to 30 centimeter, yeah, square area. So minimum 10 pair you will release, no problem, 10 pair of coccinellids. So here what we'll do, here cannibalism is there, I told already, grubs and adults are predator. So here what are the cannibalism is there, the adult coccinellids is maybe is fed on the eggs also, and the second one maybe the grubs, the big one is fed on the small also, and it's maybe what happened in the people stage is there, some of the people stage, the adult maybe is fed on the people stage. So it's a lot of cannibalism it is there inside the this coccinellid. To avoid that cannibalism, what we'll do, so you will maybe we'll make it on small rolls. You see the photo how we are maintaining, like chart paper, you will take the chart paper, you will make it like cylinder size, you put inside the container for 10 or 20. That is a character of predator. Maximum predator what happened, maximum lay the eggs in some hunting place only. So here also this coccinellid, maximum coccinellid is lay the eggs inside this cylinder only. Okay. So yeah, every day or alternate day, just you will see inside the this paper. If any egg mass is there, immediately you collect the egg mass, you keep in the petri dish. That is very, very important. So whatever egg mass is there, you collect and you keep in the petri dish. Just within a short time, within 2 to 3 days, the egg will catch. After catching, immediately release into the fresh container. That is very, very important. So don't mix grubs and adult. And don't mix in different stage also. For example, one container, aphid infected container is there. So you release only the first instar only. You maintain the almost within 1 or 2 days, whatever catch is there, you release inside the container. Don't mix in different stages. So the grub stage, maximum it is 2 to 3 weeks. We have 3 stages there. After that, just you release the you keep in the egg trays, because that grubs is going to the pupa. So maximum the pupa it is going to inside the egg trays only. Then the pupa will emerge into the adult. So whatever the adult did, that directly you will maintain for the further mass production. Here the cannibals a video I have, but here it is not working. And the second one, I saw so many publication is there for artificial tight. Frankly, I am telling, I don't know how it is working, but it is working for first one generation. The after that, the fecund is very very poor. So better you will take for natural tight. You will get the good result. The next important predator, spider, is a very common predator, not only for maize ecosystem, all ecosystem. So this also is possible for mass production. So this whatever it is there, this all are it is recorded in NAPTHAM farm. So what we'll do now, here you will take on a big container. Yes, you see the length is almost 30 centimeter big container, plastic container. Then you will take on small syringe bottle. You put the water and you keep the fresh leaves, any leaves. Okay, if any ornamental plant or something, just you will make it on branch only. Just you keep inside the this syringe cotton with cover with the cotton. Okay. So whatever your preparation, you keep inside the container. So now this is a chamber. Just nothing like we are maintaining the like natural condition. That's because the spider is not surviving in the empty plastic container. It's required some supporting. So it will make it that some natural container. Food better you will take larva. Okay, any larva. So in laboratory condition, culture is very easy. Any larva, just you release inside the container. And next, nucleus culture taken from, if you want, you will take from spider from the field. Better you will take that greenling spider. It's very common. It's a very good predator for easy farmer the production also. Don't collect in the web spider. It's a non-web spider. Okay. So greenling spider is very easy. Just you collect one male and female. Very easy identification also. You see the abdomen, you know. You collect both male and female. Then you release inside the container. So, but maximum over 3-4 days is required for mating. After that, you separate both male and females. Otherwise, what happened now, it is survey only females only. You know that all insects, not only for insect, that this pattern also, females are dominant. Okay. So, you keep inside, you release inside, then you cover with muslin cloth. The females, here each and every category should be made in only one spider only. Don't put more than one. Okay, only one spider. The female mites lay the egg mass. You see the egg sac. Okay, egg sac. It lay the eggs in the cloth only. Maximum the cloth or sometime in the plant also. Okay. This egg, one egg mass is there. Means you will open that one minimum 200 to 300 eggs are there. Minimum 200 to 300 spider links is coming from the egg mass. So one more character here, what is then the females always, maximum that after egg laying, the catching period of minimum 21 to 28 days. That 28 days, the female spiders always attaching with the egg mass only. Okay. So one female is during the life cycle, maximum is lay the egg 3 to 4 sac. So after catching, you see that small spider links is coming from the egg mass. So the spider links directly release into the field. That is very very important. Otherwise, what happen without food, with food also, what happen is more number is there. Minimum 200 to 300 number of spider links is there inside the container. So more cannibalism option it will happen. So to avoid the cannibalism, whatever directly you release into the So this is a very good predator for management of our pests. This is a very easy method to conserve the all the whatever the spent work predator and parasite, whatever it is there. So to maintain some flowering plants, you maintain the ecology technique. So provide the food, example the nectar and the pollen shelter and alternate prey for built up our natural enemies population. The field as well as the provide the refuse site during the in-ground weather and the off season. And I give the one small size and don't spray anything without any recommendation and also unwanted things. So before spraying, just you'll go for the proper monitoring. Then as per the recommendation go for the spraying. So these all are recorded. We are taken from NIPHM. These different natural enemies is recorded in our field. This is our NIPHM field for survey. And we are teaching the training institute. So we are demo to the trainees. So thank each and everyone for giving this opportunity. Sharing my screen. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. If any clarification or questions, please ask.
Thank you, Dr. Jasurajan, for the wonderful lecture on the predators, especially spiders are one important aspect you have added. You have covered redwood bug, pentatomid bug, anthocarid, and lacewings, coccinellid spiders, which are the important predators for us to know what are the main predators in the maize ecosystem. So friends, if you have any questions and queries, you can ask Dr. Jasurajan. Yeah, he has accepted tons of all the questions.
Yes. If any questions, please.
Let me check the chat box. More questions. Jasu, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir.
For the wonderful presentation. Giving you your valuable time because you are busy in your many trainings you are organizing.
Sorry, sir, I have one more class, that's why I closed exactly the time. So thank you so much, sir.
I know the problems because from NIPHM sparing time is very important.
Yes,
sir. Thanks for sharing your experience in mass production of predators, especially for the fall armyworm management. Thank you, Dr. Jasurajan.
Thank you so much.
We thank Jasurajan for giving a wonderful lecture. Now I request Dr. Subi, S.B. Subi. She is working as scientist in Indian Institute of Maize Research at Delhi unit. Earlier she worked at DRDO Gwalior in 2008 to 2009, and she is very much experienced in the especially integrated pest management aspect and agro-system analysis and all aspects. So she is instrumental in preparing the PVP what we are seeing with in collaboration with NBR, NCIPM and IIMR. She is the main lead in the preparation of PVP for fall armyworm, different types of corn, grain corn, baby corn, sweet corn, and then silage and fodder corn. So she has more than 60 papers in and several popular articles and teaching and technical. She has taken a very lead role in during when they initially the fall armyworm appeared in 2018-19, traveled very widely in giving the awareness programs along with our colleague S.L. Jart, who is exclusively looking after the MEH region maize program. And also he is now the looking after the diversification program in Punjab and Haryana states, diversification program. So now I welcome Dr. Subi to present on agro system analysis and landscape management of farm. Dr. Subi, please.
Sir, thank you so much. Sir, my screen is visible. Is it sharing?
Not yet, Subi.
Okay. Sir, please give me 2 minutes. I need to get the help of somebody.
Yeah, we are facing problem. Na? Google Meet, yeah. We are not every year.
Yes.
Where is that? The idea has come, Subhi. Now it is appearing. We are seeing the screen.
Hello. Hello, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you able to see my slide in full screen?
Your desktop is visible.
Oh.
Yeah, now it is visible. Yeah.
Okay. Sir, is it in slideshow mode?
Keep it in slideshow.
Is it moving now?
Not yet.
Second slide.
Moving, yeah. Okay.
Sir, it is.
Yeah, it is coming. Moving.
Sir, the second slide, it is coming. The agro ecosystem and the analysis.
Yeah.
Yes.
It has come. Please.
Yes. Go ahead. Okay. I thank FAO for giving this opportunity to present the topic on the agro ecosystem and analysis and landscape management of fall amoeba. Good afternoon, everybody. And we will start seeing what is this. And you can see the two panels. One above, it has the pest, and the second panel we have the natural enemies. Now we will see what is the importance of agro ecosystem analysis and how it has evolved from the economic our pest management based on the economic threshold level. So there is this in the earlier times when after the green revolution, we know that we don't have to dump the pesticide. We have to practice the holistic approach of IPM by maintaining a healthy diversity in the ecosystem. But we were considerate only in the number of pests which is present in the ecosystem, present in a particular crop, and we have standardizing them based on the yield loss. In the case of stem borer, if there is 10% of the dead heart, if you are seeing, we have to go for a spray. Otherwise, it can lead to an economic loss. But that has led to the unmindful application of so many pesticides in the past, and our biodiversity has lost, so was the ecosystem health. So now it has evolved it into agro ecosystem analysis. It is the pillar of integrated pest management. So this is what the agro ecosystem analysis means. This I have taken from a paper, and this we can see that it is not the sole maize crop alone. Now we are going back to the basic, how the agriculture has evolved. First it was a slash and burning system, then we have gone for the mixed cropping, then we have gone for the structured intercropping, we have come to the monocropping, and our agro ecosystem started degrading. Now we are slowly going back to the bare basics. In that you can see that it is a maize bean intercropping Uganda, and here in the right panel we can see the participants are how the it is a agro ecosystem analysis. It is a practical thing. We are now teaching it through a online mode, but we can imagine when we are in the field, we won't see the crop alone. We will see everything, which crop is that, and it has a what is the season, whether it is kharif or rabi, what are the crops, what are the pests, then what is the soil condition, what was your variety of the crop, because it has a bearing with the host plant resistance. Then what is the weed status, what is the previous crop. When your previous crop is a weed, you may have a less number of weeds in the coming season, like that. It is depending upon the coverage, what crop covered your land before the previous before the crop, which is in the field now. So we'll see that these are the basic component of agroecosystem analysis. It is the pest and the different population dynamics, because they are always in the field. The defenders, they act from morning. They are acting continuously. Some of the beetles, they are like earwigs. They are very much active in the night. In the dawn and the dusk, you will get bats which are coming, which we have recorded even in our own field. They're coming to hunt the moths. Then as the in the morning, you will get a number of birds. Then these parasitoids and predators, they are acting all the time. Next is the plant health at the various stages, because the crop like a maize have a good foliage coverage. It has a good foliage compensation ability. If some amount of foliage is removed, nothing happened to the maize plant, and it is sufficient to produce a good yield. So your plant health will decide the compensation ability of the plant. Then the soil condition, a good fertile soil with a good carbon content and other soil, good soil physical and chemical properties, which it will give a healthy crop. And next is the climatic factors. If it is in a warm, humid condition, it is congenial to the insect growth. If it is a cool, humid condition, it is congenial to the fungus growth. We know that we are in the tropics, we are getting many pests, but in the temperate climate, we are getting many diseases. Everything is depending upon the climatic factors. Then the next is the farmer's past experience. What they have experienced, we can visualize in the case of fall armyworm, when it was invaded in 2018, the farmers came to know it when the crop was half eaten, because we have not seen something like that in the past. We were having the stem borers in the beginning, and they really caused an yield loss before the single cross hybrid came, because the stem borer caused the damage up to 1 month of the crop. And if you have a good seed rate, you don't even have to spray the pesticide to compensate the yield loss because of the stem borers. But a shoot fly, which comes in the spring in the northwestern India, it was really a problem, which was killing the maize plant almost 100% if you plant it after February 15th without seed treatment. So we know all the scenario. Everything is depending upon the climate. We have a special niche for a particular pest, and which is acting accordingly. So this, in the case of fall armyworm, when it came, and we have applied whatever based on our past experience on the stem borer management, we started applying carbofuran and 4-8. But this pest has already developed resistance to OP pesticide and the OP and the carbamate pesticide in 1960s and 70s itself in the Americas. So after there, they have introduced the BT corn there. So it has, this population was, fall armyworm population was coming down there. Also, they have many sort of other thing. They are taking a holistic management approach there. Even though this fall armyworm has developed even resistance to BT cotton there. But the only thing what with us is that we can manage it very effectively if we will be able to keep our eyes open, have a close watch, identify them early, and manage them. So the first step is, which is the pest coming into your field? We got so many pictures in the beginning. The first picture, we know it is a typical symptom of the fall armyworm. It will hide in the world and it will eat from the world. So we will get holes in the world. It will stay in the world only. In the second picture, we can see it is also an armyworm attack. It is not a fall armyworm. It is eating from the margin. It shows that this armyworm has a it doesn't have a habit of hiding in the world. It used to eat and go. It used to abandon the field and go to the next field. What we are seeing in the third picture is a complete defoliation. It has happened in an all overnight. So who can cause it? It is caused by the locust and the grasshopper. It is a common phenomena in the central western India. So we know how to identify the pest, how to identify the fall armyworm, then the oriental armyworm and the grasshopper. But the thing is that we have to identify them from the symptom, because often when we go in the morning, this insects won't be there. Only we are seeing the symptom. So we have to train our eyes to identify the symptom, the pest from the symptom. And now, how we can monitor the important thing in an IPM is to monitor the pest dynamics. So in the case of fall armyworm, we have a pheromone that we recommend to put 4 pheromone trap in 1 acre. It is not necessary that if you have a contiguous stretch of 10 acres, then to 10 hectare, don't have to put everywhere. You have to put trap in any one acre in the field, which is just for monitoring whether your pest has come. What caution we have to take? We are getting 2 pests in this trap. We are getting fall armyworm or Scelesimethinia lauri in that. It is because of some peculiar thing with their biology. One more thing is that we are getting this Methymna only when in the winter season, when the fall armyworm population is low. So when we are catching, we got some videos also, we are catching so many more moths in the trap, but the field don't have much damage. Then when you closely observe the video, we found that it is not a fall armyworm, it is something else. So these things we have to take care. So here, then we have to keep a keen eye on which pest is falling into your trap. But the most important thing is have a watch on the crop. It won't make you fool. So here we can say it is a July sown crop. It is 20th July. Our plant in here in our campus, it was only 5 day old crop. We know that it is a very humid, hot condition. Your crop will grow fast. Also, it is a very congenial for the pest. But this pest is so clever, fall armyworm. It has laid its egg on the lower surface of the leaf. So it will be so difficult for a farmer to identify the pest has come. How we went into the field, we were from the behavior of the pest from the past, we were sure that it will be coming when the maize is around 2-leaf stage. So we were continuously monitoring. As soon as the crop got 3-leaf stage, it is about to be 3-leaf stage, and the 2-leaf stage, yeah, just it has only 2 fully open leaf, 2-leaf stage, we got a leg laying, we could see 1 to 2 plants. When we observed, almost 100% of the plants were having eggs. So this pest is so clever, so we have to have a keen eye on the pest behavior, where it lays eggs. Then when we then the defenders, we saw the pest, then what are the things coming in the field? So they come in the egg laying stage, we have the egg parasitoids and the Trichogramma chelonis, they are getting in the south. But we are observing for the 2 years, we have not got Trichogramma or Telenomus yet, but we are getting Chelonis species as the egg larval parasitoid. It is from Haryana or Punjab, and we are getting this pest only. Then the most active, the other predators which are active early stages are the coccinelles, row beetles. Then the predatory pentatomids, they comes in a bit of later stage, and all these earwigs are there. Then if it is a humid, cool condition, you can, a somewhat cooler condition, you can get a metarhizium relay also. It is very common in the Karnataka. It comes in the end of September when at the crop formation stage, when the fall armyworm is about to enter the crop. In south, they are getting a high population of metarhizium relay. But here in in this part of India, in the northwestern India, which is a bit of dry, we are not getting any fungal pathogen. So everything is depending upon the weather. Now coming to the defenders, the insectivorous birds play a very good role. When we can see them, these pictures I have taken at 6 o'clock in the field. They are very much active in the morning and the evening. And suppose if we in 2019 we got a report from Bihar, and it was also came in the newspaper that the crows are dying. And they told they died due to fall amoeba. But I was very much sure they have not died because of fall amoeba. They have died because of eating the fall amoeba poisoned with carbofuran and forate. And some of our friends from NGO, when they have went and they asked what are the pesticides they applied, because they were not knowing when it came in the first time. They applied forate and furidan, and the insect was of a bit like, it was not dying, but it was a weak, and the insect, it became easy prey for the birds, and the birds can die due to our ignorance of the ecosystem. So these things, why we have to see them? Because the what pesticide we have to use, which are the safer pesticide. So in this case, when the we cannot compromise with the yield, we cannot compromise with the ecosystem also. When the crop is at the early stage, we can safely spray neem. When it is of a bigger stage, when we see that the neem cannot control, the insect has gone a bigger stage, we have to spray the chlorantraniliprole. It is a comparatively safest among the synthetic pesticides recommended for fall amoeba control, then Spinosyna. But we know that the most cheapest is imamectin benzoate. We will see it. And how the pillar of the agroecosystem analysis is the weekly scouting. Every week we have to go and see, because the early day detection is the key. Yesterday, madam from Jeshipur was asking that we have applied the pesticide metarhizium relay, metarhizium anisoply in the field, why it is not dying. So it is definitely, it has a bearing with the stage of the damage. If it is at the early stage, it can be controlled with neem pesticide, a biopesticide. When it goes beyond a stage, we cannot. So we'll see. So we cannot see the entire 1 acre, you cannot go and observe. So we can do the sampling from walking into the field in a zigzag pattern. From 5 points in the field, we can observe 10 plants and record how many plants are infested. You don't have to carry a paper also. You just can calculate. It is better if you can carry. Otherwise, you can calculate it in your mind. How many infested plants I'm seeing from a point. So here we are getting 18% of the infestation, and it is in the papery window stage, only scrapping. So we can assume that only the first and second instar is there. We can immediately go for a neem spray, and we can wait for next week. We can come back, and if it is in the whole stage, and if it is, then we can go for the other management practice. So this we recommend on citing the four moths or egg masses, or in this scrapping damage, we recommend to spray the neem, because we have seen it has a repellent effect also. One more thing we have not